Hello, I'm very excited to tell you about shared philosophies between the Julia programming language and Emacs. While Julia and Emacs might look like different pieces of software, I think there is profound commonalities between the two. Let's start by introducing Julia. Julia is a high-level dynamic programming language. Julia is free and open source software and is used primarily for scientific computing. The reason Julia is used for scientific computing is that while Julia is high level and has a syntax that looks like Python or MATLAB, Julia can be high performance. I use it to develop climate models that run on hundreds of GPUs, models that are traditionally developed with C, C++, or Fortran. But how is this possible? How can Julia be high performance, but also high level at the same time? What makes Julia, Julia? Well, what makes Julia, Julia is the idea of multiple dispatch. Multiple dispatch is the concept where function call is resolved by looking at the types of every single argument involved. So let's explore this with this example. Here, I define a function add that takes two objects and some string together, and I call add with two different types, first with just integers and second with floats. So let's look at what this produces. Here is the output of add and Julia. So first we have add, a function with one method. I'm going to explain this in a second. And then we have our return values 12 and 12.0. What we cannot see here is that Julia has specialized code for the two different function calls, for integers and for floating point. Let's make this more explicit by specifically providing a new method for the case with floating point. So here now I have an add function specifically for floating point. Instead of taking a plus b, this returns a exponent b, let's call this. And what we can see here is that now we have two methods. So we add a new method to the same function. This is a method that is specifically for floating points. And instead of having the value 12, we have 100. And this is where the trick lies. Julia compiles the most specialized version that can be compiled. So a version with integers, versions with floats, and in this, compiling is an actual completion with LLVM, with optimization, and so on. This is a just ahead of time completion. As soon as the Julia knows the type, a function is compiled if it's not compiled already, and then it's used. When types are stable and well inferred, this can lead to code that is as performant or comparable to C and Fortran. So this is what makes Julia, Julia. Multiple dispatch with just ahead of time completion of highly efficient code. So now, what makes Emacs Emacs? Well, in my opinion, what makes Emacs Emacs is interactivity, extensibility, and community. And I claim that Julia has the same three. And that interactivity, extensibility, and community are three key pillars for Julia. More specifically, Julia encourages a REPL-driven, introspective, and interactive workflow. Is largely open to extension and modification, to the point that most of Julia is written in Julia. And Julia is a thriving and welcoming community with lots of packages. So let me showcase a little bit of this REPL-driven introspective interactive workflow with the hope that commonalities with Emacs will emerge naturally. So let's start by opening a Julia REPL. Here I have a Julia REPL. Let me give you a tour of the Julia REPL. So the REPL comes with lots of useful features, from a shell to a package manager. So for example, let's add the random package. I added random package. I can look at what's inside. We have statistics with random in this particular environment. Environments are fully declarative. So here we have the dependencies of this environment, and I can explore in this manifest the specific versions that are used. So we have a shell, we have a package manager, and then we have a very powerful help system. So for example, I can ask for help for length, and here we can see we have, well, the help for length. Lots of information about how to call length, the expected return values, examples. And now you can probably start seeing that this is not that different from calling length. So this is the output for length, or for help for length in Emacs. So we have help, and we can do more. We can even look at the source code for length. So now what we can see here is that now Well, we cannot see because it's too zoomed in, because the font size is huge, but in this page here, we can see the implementation of length is this line here in the middle, or is these few lines here in the middle. And as you, or let's do this again, as we can see here at the bottom, what we're looking at, this is the source code of Julia. We can change this. There's even a macro edit if you want to change length. And yeah, I use the word macro. Julia supports metaprogramming. And actually, metaprogramming is one of the key features in Julia. It's used extensively in the core, but it's also used extensively in packages, both to extend the Julia ecosystem and functionalities, but also to develop full domain-specific languages. Some of the useful macros are, well, I don't know, like time. Here we have built-in Bigsy performance tool in Julia. And I want to showcase more introspection macros. But for that, I'm going to do it slightly different. I'm going to open a file, example.jl, where I define a function, or our function add. There was an asterisk, and I'll go back to that in a second. So now I'm going to include this file, and I can call my function add, 1 and 2, and we get 3. And now what I can do is this, that I can look at what code gets compiled when I call 1 plus 2. And here, now we can see that there is some integer stuff, but if I make this floating point, now the compiled code changes. Now maybe assembly code is a little bit too hard to read, so I can look at the LLVM IR representation. In this case, we can see that there is promotion. The promotion will probably go away if I make everything float. So this with f add, floating point add, or double, but we can also look at the Julia lowered representation after the abstract scenario is produced. The reason I put this in a file is because now what I can do is I can change this, and now 1 and 2 will be 2. So this to me is very reminiscent of how I work in Emacs, where there's a global state that I can access and modify anytime with no restrictions. And this happens in Julia too. Typically, we don't want to modify functions that are in other packages or that are in base, but we can do that. For example, I can change what is plus for integers. And if I change what is plus and make it so that any two integers return 0, well, I can do this. This will break Julia because, well, Julia is built in Julia, so if we break this, well, nothing will work. But I can do that. This, to me, is one of the signs of the powerful introspective and powerful interactive type of workflows that Julia enabled. Finally, I want to talk about the general registry. This is the equivalent of Melpa. It comes with Julia, but this is very akin to Melpa. It's built upon Git, essentially. It's collaborative. It relies heavily on GitHub, GitLab. It's heavily automated and comes with lots and lots of tools and packages. What's beautiful about all these tools and packages is that in the same way many of Emacs packages just play nicely with each other without any input from the developers, the same is true for Julia packages. The Julia packages are highly composable, so two developers can develop two distinct packages that end up playing nicely together for free because of the intrinsic structure and intrinsic way Julia objects are built. So, with all of this, I also want to mention that the community, in addition to having all these packages, is highly active, highly collaborative. The community meets regularly on places like Slack, as opposed to the Emacs community that I'd say maybe meets on Reddit. So with all of this, I want to thank you for your attention. Enjoy Emacs, enjoy Julia.